Good morning. We have general questions. Question number one, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what information it has regarding the many local how many local authorities use the Water Direct scheme to deduct water and sewage charges, and whether this includes Midlothian and East Lothian councils.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
Presiding Officer, the use of Water Direct is a matter for individual local authorities in collaboration with the Department for Work and Pensions. And as such, the Scottish Government does not retain a list of local authorities using the scheme. The Scottish Government does, though, recognise that Water Direct is being used in Scotland and is working to facilitate discussions between relevant parties to support the development of a common understanding of the appropriate use of this scheme.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. Given the Scottish Government's commitment to poverty reduction and to alleviating the impact of changes to benefit payments brought in by the Westminster Government, has the Cabinet Secretary offered any guidance to local authorities regarding the need to take into account the customer's ability to pay and whether a benefits deduction for water and sewage charges or debt resulting from unpaid water and sewage charges will cause financial hardship to the customer before the local authority applies to the DWP to make deductions from the benefits payment?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a good point, but he will be aware there is a matter for local authorities to decide what tools to use to collect water charges and in what circumstances they should apply any particular approach. However, it is important that any debt recovery tool, including Water Direct, is used responsibly. And so a forum is being established that the Scottish Government will chair to ensure that stakeholders, including customer representatives, can discuss the implications for different groups of individuals of using Water Direct and other charge recovery methods, with a view to establishing a common understanding of good practice that best protects the most financially hard-pressed. It's also worth noting, Presiding Officer, that water charges in Scotland are on average £39 lower than in England and Wales and have been falling in real terms in recent years. The linkage to council tax means charges are the most progressive in the whole of the UK.
Question number two, Christian Allard.
To ask the Scottish Government when the next review of the industry authority Seafish is scheduled to take place.
Minister Aileen MacLeod.
Following the report of the Smith Commission, options for making administrative changes to Seafish have been under discussion across the four UK fisheries administrations. We do not believe these discussions address the fundamental flaws inherent in Seafish as a reserve body attempting to operate in an area where policy is devolved. We have therefore asked the UK Government to support the devolution of powers to raise and administer food levies, including the seafood levy currently administered by Seafish, via legislative change to the Scotland Bill. Now, once such powers are devolved, we shall be in a position to undertake a proper and fundamental review of food levies in Scotland, including Scotland's place in Seafish and the implications for the role of that body within the UK.
Christian Allard.
Thanks, Minister, for the answer, but I'm quite surprised because, of course, this type of body, UK-wise, have to have a regular review every 3 years. And as I understand it, the last review was to be taking place last year in 2014. The Smith Commission asked for the Scottish and UK government to work together on this, and I'll ask the Minister if the discussion has been taking place and have not ended up yet as a devolution that we want to have, even isn't it time for Seafish to be reviewed out of Scotland?
Minister.
Christian Allard is absolutely right to point out that a review of Seafish is overdue. Indeed, we believe that a fundamental overhaul of the arrangements for raising and administering seafood levies has been pressing for some time now. Following the report of the Smith Commission, options for making administrative changes to Seafish have been under discussion across the four UK fisheries administrations, but we do not believe that these discussions address the fundamental flaws inherent in Seafish as a reserve body attempting to operate in an area where policy is devolved. And this was recently demonstrated, Presiding Officer, when Seafish chose to use the UK Fish and Chip Shop Awards, deservedly won this year by a Shetland business, as a vehicle for the Norwegian Seafood Council to promote the marketing of frozen Norwegian whitefish into the UK market. And while that plays to the interests of powerful importers of frozen fish elsewhere in the UK, it fails to put Scottish interests first. So we've therefore asked the UK Government to support the devolution of powers to raise and administer food levies, including the seafood levy currently administered by Seafish, via legislative change to the Scotland Bill. And once such powers are devolved, we shall be in a position to undertake that proper and fundamental review of food levies in Scotland, including Scotland's place in Seafish and the implications for the role of that body within the UK.
Jamie McGregor.
Thank you. I share the industry's concerns that any suggestion that Seafish should in any way be promoting Norwegian seafood, given the quality and sustainability of our own Scottish fish. The UK government has said it is prepared to work closely with the Scottish government on giving Scotland a greater say over how the levies are spent. Can the Cabinet Secretary update us on these talks and the priorities, or sorry, the Minister update us on this and her priorities for spending on seafood promotion in Scotland?
Minister.
Well, I'm very happy to write to the member with some further details around that form, make sure we give him as comprehensive as information as we possibly can.
Question number three, Patricia Ferguson.
To ask the Scottish Government what its views are on bus re-regulation.
Minister, Derek Mackay.
Our position hasn't changed in that I have no plans for wholesale re-regulation, but want to see closer partnership working between operators and transport authorities. We're shortly bringing forward legislation making changes to the registration of bus services, and this provides an opportunity for the sector to demonstrate how it can work together to better manage changes to the bus network.
I thank the Minister for that answer, Presiding Officer, but I have to say I do find it very disappointing. I'm sure I'm not the only constituency or list MSP whose communities have been blighted over the years by the relatively fast withdrawal of bus services from local communities, mostly recently the M3 bus and the 10 bus in my constituency. And it seems to me that transport authorities are also hidebound in this regard, because their current guidance means that they have no opportunity to intervene when there is another or a similar service operating in those areas, which is the case with these two particular instances I mentioned. So I really would ask the Minister to think again, and if he's not content to have, as he described it, wholesale re-regulation, perhaps he could look at another model that might actually give communities the opportunity to have a say in the decisions being made that so badly affect them.
Minister?
I think there are proposals that I have outlined that will assist in terms of bus services across Scotland. There's also the provision already within legislation for quality contracts, which says local franchising and quality bus partnerships. In addition to that, through community planning and strengthened community planning, local transport strategies could be addressed. I would disagree with the point that there's no opportunity to intervene. Local transport authorities can intervene if there's assessed social need and implement subsidised services. The legislative change that I'm proposing surrounds the ability to engage for better engagement with local authorities in assessing transport changes through bus regulation. I'm sure that will be welcomed by the whole chamber. But on the issue of wholesale re-regulation, if Patricia Ferguson's disappointed, I'm sure she'd be equally disappointed in her own colleague, Ian Gray, who abandoned his bill, which was apparently about re-regulation. But like many things with the Labour Party, it wasn't quite what it said on the tin. David Stewart brokered a meeting between me and Ian Gray, and I was happy to be supportive to strengthen the legislation, but it was Mr Gray who withdrew his bill. So I'll do what I can through grant conditions, through transport strategy, through strengthened community planning and the national transport strategy to support local communities working in partnership with the bus industry, rather than bring the kind of volatility that I think the Labour Party would reap upon the public transport system of Scotland.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Is it not the case that re-regulation would cost more than £750 million? And it is a height of cynicism for the Labour Party to suggest such a thing when they know that the comprehensive spending review is likely to have further cuts to an already diminished Scottish budget.
Minister.
Well, Mr Gibson's right in the respect that wholesale re-regulation or indeed re-nationalisation would be incredibly expensive. But just like on the situation with the Labour proposition on the railways, they say it's re-nationalisation and then it turns out it's not. What Labour say is not necessarily what they do. They didn't deliver re-regulation administration. They're not even proposing it now in opposition, having abandoned their bill. That's why we'll take the right pragmatic and practical steps to support local communities in engaging changes to bus services whilst maintaining the National Concessionary Travel Scheme, BSOG and other measures to try and support accessibility and connectivity right across the country. And we'll do so in partnership with the Confederation of Passenger Transport. I know that that's the kind of conditions that will lead to enhanced public transport in Scotland.
Alice McInnes.
Thank you very much. As the Minister hinted at, there are a suite of options for local authorities to improve bus services, quality partnerships, quality contracts and punctuality improvement plans. When did the Government last review the take-up of these mechanisms? Is he able to tell the Chamber how many there are? And does he plan to review or refresh the bus strategy generally?
Minister?
Well, the good news is, yes, the refresh of the National Transport Strategy is underway as we speak, and I've set a very challenging timescale for it to be concluded by Christmas. And within that, there will be the imminent legislative and regulatory changes that I have proposed and will be shared with the Chamber, and there will be the National Transport Strategy Review, in which we have to prioritise bus transport if we want to get the modal shift from the car into public transport. I'm equally disappointed that the local authorities and transport partnerships haven't taken up quality bus partnerships or quality contracts, and if I can make it easier for them to do that, I will do it. But sometimes it's about resource, not necessarily regulation, but there are the tools to do the job at the local level, and local authorities need to seize those opportunities and make it happen to help address need. And that's why it's those kind of practical measures and not necessarily blanket wholesale re-regulation that will make the difference, because it can be done, and it can be done now.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. It's regrettable if this issue gets seen as just another example of Labour-SNP rivalry. Isn't it clear, if we look around Europe, to the kind of countries that enjoy the excellent public transport service provision that Scotland deserves but doesn't have, one thing is clear. They regulate firmly, they subsidise, and not just at the margins, and they recognise that the private sector alone, a free market approach, doesn't deliver the goods.
Minister?
Well, I'd point out that the subsidy to the bus network is around 45% of total bus incomes, about 45% of public sector subsidy. I think there's more we can do around integrated transport. I think there's more we can do around smart cards and partnership and local connections, and all that work is underway. So again, I disagree that re-regulation, wholesale re-regulation, is the answer when there's a suite of actions that I think will improve bus patronage in Scotland. But we should celebrate the positives and empower people at the most local level to address social need where it's established, and it is my job to ensure that the conditions are there to do that, and that's exactly why we're refreshing the National Transport Strategy to make it clear to local authorities they have the power to take action now to address need, but in a pragmatic and positive way.
Neil Bibby.
I've been contacted by many constituents in Renfrewshire, the area the Minister also represents, concerned about the high price of bus fares and a lack of services, particularly in the evening. I've also been contacted by bus passengers in Clydebank who are dismayed they can't get a direct bus to the new Queen Elizabeth University Hospital. Some pensioners have to get free buses to travel just 7 miles for a hospital appointment. If the Minister isn't going to regulate the bus industry, which he's clearly not, can he tell us what is he actually going to do to address these problems that are facing bus users on a daily basis?
Minister?
I don't think that Neil Bibby has been listening to me. I've been outlining the actions in the National Transport Strategy, the ability of quality contracts or quality bus partnerships, the investments and the subsidies we're making, or in terms of previous answers I've given, if there is social need, how local authorities and transport partnerships can address that, or wider issues around the personalised journey and the contacts can be made through Travel Line to support that. In addition to all of that, fantastic investment in public transport of over £1 billion every year, including the bus industry. And Neil Bibby says he's disappointed that I'm not re-regulating, and he'll also be disappointed, Ian Gray, that even the Labour Party is no longer proposing re-regulation either by abandoning the very bill that was to do that very act. So we'll get on with the job of ensuring the satisfactory public transport and sustain the very impressive record of infrastructure investment that far surpasses anything that the previous administration was able to deliver.
Question number 4, Richard Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to promote cultural events in the North East.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The national companies are supported in 2015-16 to perform 30 times in the North East with an associated programme of over 170 workshops and events, and have specifically been asked to support the North East during the music hall revamp. Partners engaged with include schools, family centres, the Lemon Tree and the Royal Aberdeen Children's Hospital. In 2014, Creative Scotland invested £3.6 million in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire local authority areas through 35 awards. Creative Scotland has provided £90,000 funding towards Granite, a major new site-specific piece of participatory theatre made by and for the people of Aberdeen, and £130,000 funding towards the Sound Festival for its work in 2015 and 2016, promoting new music through performances, installations and learning and participation activities across Aberdeen City, Aberdeenshire and beyond. And, Presiding Officer, today I can announce that Creative Scotland are providing the Sound Festival with an additional 100 £140,000 to support next year's Sound Festival and enable Sound to deliver a high-quality, dynamic programme of education and performance during 2016 and 2017 in Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire and the North East of Scotland.
Richard Baker.
Thank the Minister for the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. A recent survey by Aberdeen and Grampian Chambers of Commerce showed that 7 out of 10 of their member businesses believe cultural investment has a strong role to play in making the city a more attractive place to live and work. Given this and the fact that, notwithstanding what the Cabinet Secretary said, funding for the arts in Aberdeen is significantly lower per capita than in our other cities, what further future plans does the Scottish Government have to promote arts in the city? And the Cabinet Secretary, I'm very, very welcome the announcement on the Sound Festival, but does she believe also that Creative Scotland should consider awarding the Sound Festival funding from its core funding stream to secure its long-term future beyond next year?
Minister.
I very much welcome the survey that he's highlighted with businesses in Aberdeen recognising the culture offer has been very important to economic growth. Delighted to hear that. And in terms of what we can do for investment, I would point out that in terms of the statistics he cites in relation to per head of population, that's from where the applicant resides as opposed to where the arts activity takes place. And obviously the infrastructure of having more organisations that can apply for regularly funded activity from Aberdeen particularly would be helpful, bearing in mind that 100% of those that apply for regular funding from Aberdeen itself did achieve regular funding. And can I say in terms of the Sound Festival, delighted that he welcomes our announcement today, but over the period since 2012, the Sound Festival has almost £500,000 of investment, recognising the quality of what it produces. But clearly we want to ensure that not just the central, but every part of Scotland can enjoy the great cultural performances that this country has to offer.
Question 5, Jim Hume.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide a progress report on how the Borders Rail Link is operating.
Minister Derek Mackay.
Patronage on the Borders Railway has been exceptional since its opening, with nearly 200,000 journeys being made in the first 6 weeks. Some performance issues have resulted from these busy services, which ScotRail are mitigating through additional carriages on some affected services. The performance of the Borders Railway has been closely monitored alongside the rest of the Scottish Rail network.
Jim Hume.
I thank the Minister for his answer. The Minister will be aware that some of the services, have been cancelled because of overcrowding. Does the Minister think it's acceptable for ScotRail to advise passengers which trains are busier than others so that customers can make alternative options? And can the Minister tell the passengers what he's doing in conjunction with ScotRail to increase capacity on a longer-term basis? And, of course, would he give a clear commitment today that he will initiate talks with stakeholders to get a feasibility study underway into extending the line to Carlisle so that even more communities can reap the benefits?
Minister.
Well, we've made it clear that we would judge the performance of the Borders Railway and talk with the Regional Transport Partnership in terms of a future feasibility study. Yes, we'll engage with stakeholders. I do think it's helpful to advise passengers when the busiest trains are, because some are leisure passengers that might want to avoid the busier time. So I do think actually that's helpful advice. But most importantly, what has the Government and ScotRail done to address the huge success that is Borders Rail? That has meant adding extra carriages and in some cases doubling the capacity at certain times to try and address that success story. And there's been immense positive economic impact as a consequence of the Borders Rail, and we'll look further at improving the capacity and the rolling stock, which has been used to the maximum within Scotland to address the now fantastic demand levels for the success story, which is Borders Rail. And in due course, we'll have new trains, 70 new Hitachi electric trains coming to Scotland, and that allows us to cascade existing rolling stock across the country. I hear Jim Hume saying it's not happening quickly enough. You can't magic up new trains, but we've ordered them through the franchise, and I tell you, if the Liberal Democrats were in power, there would indeed be no overcrowding on the Borders Railway, because there would be no Borders Railway. It's been delivered by this government, providing a fantastic service.
Question number 6 from James Kelly has been withdrawn for understandable reasons. Question number 7, Rod Campbell.
To ask the Scottish Government how it can encourage library usage by children.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government places great importance on public libraries and everyone should have access. With our work with the Scottish Library and Information Council, we're providing support for many public library projects that encourage use by children. In August, the First Minister launched the Every Child a Library Member pilot, which the Scottish Government has funded from the Culture Portfolio, and that will work with key stages in Primary 1 with a number of different programmes to improve literacy and provide access to libraries for our children.
Very briefly, Mr Campbell.
Cabinet Secretary may be aware that 4,000 Primary 4 children in Scotland were provided with a Superstar Reader card encouraging them to take part in a six-visit challenge to libraries. Does she agree that children can only take part in these initiatives if there's adequate access to libraries, and that closing libraries would be likely to have an adverse effect on the number of children who visit them?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
I commend the programme he talks about. Clearly, libraries have a central role in our communities. We've published our National Library strategy, the Strategy for Public Libraries. Any closure has to be considered very carefully. We need libraries at the heart of our communities.
Thank you. Before we move to the next item of business, members will wish to join me in welcoming to the gallery Her Excellency Alicia Castro, the Ambassador of the Argentine Republic to the United Kingdom. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one.